it's funny when we are given a challenge as big as that one, we as human beings start questioning ourselves. And it happened even at this morning. I'm fixing breakfast for myself, and I start asking the Lord, why me? You know, why am I so important? Why have you put me in this position?
regular doctor, and he actually ended up being in the hospital. Don't think about a doctor being in the hospital, mm-hmm. but he was in the hospital, so he couldn't meet with me Wednesday. So I had to go to a different place, and God worked everything out, because I had no paperwork, but I didn't have one test. So I had to go back to my doctor's office, get a test, and they was able to get me in right away, get the results right away, and we went back. And my blood pressure was normal. And I thank God, because that's what was the problem last time. But I thank God just seeing him, you know, work in it. And then Bibiana, our daughter, we brought her here before, and she got moved down to Clarinda, Clarinda Academy. She's down there now. But one of the ladies that is involved helping her, she called us the other day, and it was such a refreshing phone call, because she really does, you can tell, you know, God gives you that spirit, His Holy Spirit. You can kind of discern the spirits that are coming at you, and you can tell that her heart is really, she wants to see BB do well. And she chatted with us probably 20 minutes about how things was going down there, and she's realistic, and she wants to get BB the help so she can make better decisions. So I thank God for her, and also I just thank God for our family and our friends and people that God brings in our life. Sometimes, you know, they just come in for a brief period, and sometimes they come to stay. But sometimes that brief period, you know, they can really help you and push you along and say, when they say this, I'll keep praying for you. That means a whole lot. When they take the time out of their life to pray for you and reach the throne of God, you know, God loves our prayers. He loves hearing from us every day. You know, and what he wants, it's like the lady shared, for us to just trust him. You know, he is the wind beneath the wings. And just to trust him and realize, you know, it's always going to work out with God. You know, because he'll make everything work out. You know, we said, you know, I have people come because they have things in life to say, well, Tim, life's so unfair. Life's so unfair. I said, yep, life's unfair, but God is not. That's who you keep your eyes on.
Praise yes, God. Amen. Amen.
Same scripture kept going over and over in my head. Trust the Lord with all your heart, lean not on your own understanding. Acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. Along with that, I was reading Proverbs 4, where it says, here, my son, the instruction of the father, attend and know their understanding. I give you good doctrine. And as I was reading Proverbs, and with the move and everything, it was stressful, it was stress-free. I hadn't
bless your father, we pray in this offering, God, as we give unto you, Lord, and as you pour out, we just thank you for your many blessings and for this elevation of your name, and by your spirit, God, as we soar by your power and your presence, God, as you draw us near, as we hunger and thirst for you in your mighty and holy name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Let's worship. We're looking for a drummer. Anyone know one? Hey, there's James. Oh, yeah, I forgot. Thank you for the reminder.
Behavior, our attitude. his. It's all his.
Right.
Yeah. Praise the Lord. And he's willing to share.
Yes.
Amen. So let's begin here in John chapter 15, verse 5. Praise God. We've got to extend some grace here too, because we've got a new man on the word back there. Praise the Lord. He's already there. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit.
Yes.
For without me, you can do nothing.
Right.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So let's look at, just to tie this in, let's look at Mark chapter 16, verses 17 and 18. He's the vine, we're the branches, right? These signs will follow them that believe. In my name, they'll cast out devils, they'll speak with new tongues. They'll take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it won't hurt them. They'll lay hands on the sick, and they will recover. Praise the Lord. Amen. Now, he just told us that if we abide in the vine, this is what happens.
Yeah.
It's the result of abiding in Christ. Fruit. So Christianity isn't about imitation. It's not about imitating Christ. It's about habitation.
Yes.
It's about being in Christ. It's about this relationship. Not about us trying to pretend that we're Jesus. We are the body of Christ.
Yep.
We're not trying to reproduce it. We just abide there. And the result is Christ.
Yes.
The glory of God shows up. So the end goal isn't a better or a more cleaned up or a more spiritual version of you.
Right.
The goal is a reflection of Jesus.
Right.
Yes.
Praise God. Jesus says our sole responsibility is to abide.
Yeah.
That's it. The only obligation, the only responsibility you have is to abide. What does abide mean? It means to live. It just means, you know, your abode is where you live, right?
Yeah.
But you abide there.
Yeah.
So our only responsibility is just to live.
Uh-huh.
Just abide. Live in Christ.
Uh-huh.
That's not imitation, church. That's not trying to be like Jesus.
No.
That's simply being in Christ.
Yes.
Which you didn't have anything to do with other than to believe.
Right.
The same thing that put you in Christ creates the fruit,
yep.
Allows that fruit, or makes this two verses of scripture right here a reality in all of our lives.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Glory.
And that relationship, out of that relationship, this is the result. And it isn't about us. It's about him. Amen?
Amen.
Now, the original word, if we get back in John 15, 5, that original word used there, abide, in the Greek, has the meaning of moving in or living with somebody. Right? In other words, it's a relational word. It's not a works word, it's just a relationship. Amen? So when we focus on abiding instead of becoming, you'll see fruit of the Spirit. You'll see fruit that you didn't think you were capable of. You'll see miracles that you didn't dream were ever going to be possible by you or in your life, you know, through your life. Amen? So let's look at John chapter 10, verse 10. We mentioned this, I mentioned it Wednesday night, but John 10, 10 is, we talk about the promises of God and the blessings of God. This ought to be one of the first ones to come to our mind.
Yes.
The thief comes not but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But I am come,
yes,
that they might have life,
yes,
and that they might have it more abundantly.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
That encompasses it. That's like, you know, in Matthew, I think it is, where he says, the whole purpose here is to have, seek the kingdom, and everything gets added. Everything comes out of that relationship. And so this is what Jesus said, I came that you're gonna, that you'll have life. would otherwise be moving.
Right.
Hallelujah.
Praise,
praise the Lord. Amen. See, you don't manufacture these things. Jesus is the only one who can produce this life in you. You can't do it.
No.
The law proved that.
Exactly.
Amen. Your responsibility is to abide.
Amen.
Amen. All right, let's go back to John 15 and look at the first four verses leading up to John 15:5, where he tells us, amen, that we are to abide, and the fruit will be produced as a result. I am the true vine, my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now this is, you know, kind of a paraphrase of what I just said. The branch in me that beareth not fruit, the only reason the branch in him that isn't bearing fruit, because it's trying to produce it instead of just abiding. So he takes that away. Now he doesn't destroy it, he just doesn't produce anything there. And every branch that beareth fruit, he does what? He makes it overflow. He purges it so that it will bring forth even more fruit.
Right.
Yes. Right? Now, you are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. We've heard this all morning long.
Yes.
It's the word that we stay focused on.
Yes, sir.
Abide in me. He is the word made flesh. Amen. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can he except you abide in me.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. You see, God doesn't say he'll make us capable. He says he'll do it in us. He's not making you more capable to do these things. He's just going to do it through you. All you do is abide. Otherwise, you're just frustrated. You're frustrated, and you're frustrating the grace of God that Paul talked about.
That's right.
Amen. Remember, the devil comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. That's his whole agenda. That's everything that he's about.
Yep. Right.
Amen. He wants to rob us of relationship and get us to focus on religion.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
That's right.
He tries to take our attention and our focus off of the relationship that we have with Christ. Mm-hmm. That's all been made possible by Christ. Amen. And direct our attention then toward imitation instead of habitation.
Yeah. Right.
Oh, do the works of Jesus. Well, that's an idiotic thing to say, to be quite honest with you. Praise the Lord. If he can get us focused on trying to do things like Jesus did it, instead of enjoying the life in relationship with him, he can trap us. Amen. You can't imitate Jesus any more successfully than you can imitate Einstein in creating thought.
True.
We always fall short.
Yeah.
We always come up short. show that mercy always dominates
right.
law or,
right.
or ritual or legalism.
Right.
And I mentioned it before. Those people that he healed on the Sabbath day, it wasn't like they were going to die before sundown.
Yeah.
He could have waited until the sun went down and healed them and everything would have been cool. He was trying to prove a point. This is the way my Father is. He doesn't want your sacrifice. He just wants to give mercy.
Amen.
And it doesn't have to be a life and death situation. Mercy is always going to prevail as far as God's concerned. But God committed his love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Amen. So that verse in itself tells me that God's objective in reaching out to us isn't to change us, it's to give us life, to give us his life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because although we didn't know it, we were already dead in our life.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord. So God's objective isn't what we sometimes, or religion often thinks that the objective is, to get you all cleaned up and changed and make you look better and behave better. God took us while we were sinners and gave us his life, eternal life, divine life, God life. That's what we got when we got born again. We didn't get fixed up. We got the pure life of God. And it made us like God, partakers of his divine nature. So that then God life could flow through us and we're miracles and the otherwise dead. See, resurrections happen all the time. We just aren't aware of it. I mentioned this, I think, at Joni's funeral. There's all kinds of resurrections. And we all experience them, and we experience them all the time. We're just not conscious of the fact that every time a miracle, every time God life flows, there's a resurrection. It isn't always a dead body that gets lifted up out of the ground. A lot of times it's a dead spirit. It's a person
yes.
who's given up hope, who's just dead in their relationship with God and maybe in other relationships. And all of a sudden, their God life flows from
yes.
somebody who just believes it. And that person has a resurrection. Things change.
Yes. Amen.
Resurrection life is the key to everything in the kingdom.
Yes.
And it's freely given. Freely you've received. Free to give.
Yes.
Praise God. Yep. So much of evangelism today is about forgiveness of sins. I get that, you know? But they generally ignore the aspect of receiving divine life. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
That's what God has given us. That's what he's made available to us. That's why he tells us, whoever said you forgive, I forgive. That sounds pretty awesome. That you can forgive sin and God will honor that. All he's saying is, I've given you divine life. You can let it flow anytime you want to.
Yeah.
Is it harder for you to say to the sick, rise up and walk, than it is to say your sins are forgiven?
Yeah.
They're both acts of God.
Yeah.
That's what Jesus was talking about. And if I've empowered you with God life, then you have that ability. So, why then? I mean, understand what I'm saying here. If that was Jesus' attitude, that was God's attitude, then why is it that we want to pick and choose the forgiveness? Maybe that has something to do with the inconsistency of the miraculous. Because it's just as miraculous for you to say to somebody who you know doesn't deserve to be forgiven based on human behavior, and yet you forgive anyone, which is exactly what Jesus did.
Yeah.
He didn't say, you know, go get your act together. I'm thinking, you know, like the tax collector. He didn't say, you know, give your money all away or, you know, pay back a certain amount and then I'm gonna accept you. No, he accepted, but the guy himself just comes out without Jesus ever asking him to do anything. He said, seven times, whatever I've taken, I'm giving back seven times to everybody,
yeah.
or whatever it was.
Yeah.
Jesus never gave him a rule by which he could be accepted.
Yeah.
He just accepted him, and the guy, out of that says, let's go back and just quickly. He comes out to steal, to kill, and destroy. I'm come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. That is grace.
Yes.
That's what that is. That's just grace.
Yes.
Praise God. See, most Christians, the way we understand Christianity revolves around an example set by some other Christian. Who's usually following religion. You know, we look at Billy Graham, or we look at, you know, nothing against any of these people that have done great things for God. I'm just saying, the way we always have a tendency to understand Christianity is based on some other Christian who usually is a religious person. Not that that makes them a bad person. women rejoice at the hope of the bride, so shall thy God rejoice over thee.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Amen. All right, look at Revelation chapter 21, verse 2. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. Mm-hmm. Praise God. See, he calls us his bride. It doesn't get any more intimate than that. Mm-hmm. Amen? You know, Hephzibah, you know what that actually means? It means my delight. And in the Hebrew English interlinear, it describes it as a fanciful way of saying my passion. Amen. Think about that. That's what God says about you. God says, Tim's my pal. You know? That's it. I mean, that's like close. You can be friends with people, you know what I mean? But to be a buddy, to be a pal, implies some sort of other thing, something closer, something, you know?
Yes.
And that's what God says. You're my pal. How many husbands and wives want to have that kind of relationship where they're best friends?
Mm-hmm.
Pals. Mm-hmm. Not just, I mean, it takes time. But to be pals, you can be friends and lose friendship because of misunderstandings and attitudes and, you know, whatever.
Sure.
But buddies kind of learn how to roll with the punches.
Right.
You know, they get it. This is my pal. This is my buddy. Yeah, I know he's a jerk, but he's still my buddy. He's my man. You know, we've learned to develop a relationship with all of that stuff. That's what God says. Ah, I see the flaws, but it's my pal. I mean, I think that's so cool.
Yes.
It doesn't diminish God. God's the one that said it. He said of Abraham, he said, I'm not going to go down there without first talking to my friend.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that's what he's saying to us, someone who was talking about discernment, you know, having discernment because of the Spirit of God. Well, we have that. Why? What is that? It's God's way of saying, look, I'm not going to do this without first checking with God.
Yeah.
I bring you on this. You know, you're my God. And Beulah means husband. What I believe the Lord is saying and trying to get us to understand is you don't have to change a thing in order to be fully accepted by God. He calls you his pal. He says, I'm your husband. Now let me tell you something. When you're dating, you might try to hide some stuff. You know? From a friend, you might even try to, you know, gloss things up a little bit, make yourself look a little better, or behave a little better, seem a little bit better. But to a pal, you just are who you are. And to your spouse, you can't hide long enough. I mean, it's going to come out. Whatever it is, it's going to show up. Because you're 24/7, you know? Or you might be able to suppress for 3 or 4 hours, or even a day, or a weekend, it's going to rear its head at the most inopportune times. Amen. And they're going to say, well, there he is with all his warts. My prince has come. And he still looks kind of like a pro. But that's what God is saying. What God is saying, look, I see no warts. It's okay, I still love him.
Yeah.
Well, I knew everything. Before I married you. So you're not going to reveal something to me I didn't already know. I love you enough to marry you regardless. You're my pal, even though I know you've got some issues. But I'll never let those issues come between this relationship that we have. Praise God. Say, well, but I don't feel like a pal. I don't feel like a bride. Sometimes I don't even want to be the husband. I don't want a divorce. I just don't want to be a husband to them. Because I got to be accountable. You know? I got to talk. When I feel like everything that could be said has already been said. Come on, just after 35 years, you're just repeating stuff. Deliberate. righteous soul from day to day with their unlawful deeds. Now we look at that and say, look, the guy, he picked the spot, and he kind of was a backstabbing little rat, you know, to his uncle, and he deserved to go right along with the rest of them. I mean, that's kind of my natural feeling about it.
Yeah.
But that's not the way God looked at it. God said he was righteous.
Yeah.
We could say the same thing about Abraham. He, you know, tries to end his wife. He lies to God. He doesn't do what God tells him. He tells him to go and have faith and stay here, and I'll bless you. There's a famine. Immediately he runs off. And God still says, that's my prophet. You need to have him pray for you.
Yeah.
You didn't do nothing wrong, but he did. But it's okay. He needs to be praying for you.
Yeah.
But see, in the Old Testament, God imputed righteousness to the believer. Amen?
Amen.
Now, the example is, he imputed, you know, righteousness to Abraham. The Bible says Abraham believed God. And God
The only way you get in Christ Jesus, the church world, is by becoming better and better and better. And that is a flesh thing. That's the flesh becoming better and better. And he said, if you want to walk in that flesh, in other words, you try to be better, you missed the boat.
Yeah.
But after the Spirit is when we accept the fact that Jesus is it.
Yes.
He, I can't be better. First of all, if we were honest, for years, maybe years ago, I used to wrestle with all of this and say, either I would feel the power of God, the Spirit of God, and yet my life was, I wasn't living the way they kept saying I should be living.
Right.
And I thought, what is going on? Either something is wrong with what they are telling me, or God, you know, I just can't believe that I could. Because sometimes after being out half the night, drinking till I hardly remember going to bed, I would get up the next morning and something would happen at work that would bring a great move of God.
Yeah.
The Spirit would just come on, and I was like, no, this is, I'm having, I just don't understand it. I do believe this. Joseph Prince said it. You're preaching it. We better believe it. Right believing causes right living.
Yes.
If I believe it right, gradually those things lose their pull.
Sure,
they're not as much fun, you know. And you want to be around people that believe like you do.
Right.
And, but, oh, yeah. You know, you just look at the Ten Commandments. It was all of flesh.
We want instant Christianity, as we understand it.
Right.
So that's why we tell people, as soon as they get saved, you know, I say. And pull down every stronghold, every thought, every imagination that disagrees with this. So as was said earlier too, anything that comes against the Word of God or opposes the Word of God, you know, your spirit immediately knows, okay, that's the Lord. Now, we may not snap to it for a day or so, but immediately, our spirit knows immediately that's not God.
Right.
It's not God because it doesn't agree with God, and God isn't in contradiction.
giving up in favor of it.
Brother.